Hello, I'm now going to take you through the whole Elizabethan England course for AQA GCSE History. It would work for other exam boards pretty well as well. This is a one-stop shop for the whole course, so I cover a lot, but I don't go into a great deal of depth. And really, to achieve the higher levels, you need to be doing more revision outside of this. But hopefully what this does, it's a good place to start. It's a good thing to do if you haven't done an awful lot of other revision, certainly something to watch just before the exam. It also gives you an opportunity to, I hope, break down your revision into manageable chunks. That's what I'm really trying to do here. So I break down the course into three parts. I break each of those down into a number of parts. And then again, I break those areas down into sort of manageable chunks as well. And those who have my spider diagrams can fill those out as they go along. This can also accompany the other videos I've done on how to answer the exam question. So this is about content. So let's start. If we're talking Elizabethan England, we should think three big areas, if you like, and you can see them there on the screen. How did Elizabeth manage her court and parliament? It's all about power. What was life like during Elizabeth's reign, and how did she deal with threats from home and abroad? And those are the three topics I'm going to go through in that order. So let's start with managing her court and parliament then. What are the big questions? Well, I would say again, when you're coming to revise and you're trying to break your revision down into manageable bits, the first question would be, who was Elizabeth? We need to ascertain that, don't we? And what problems does she inherit when she comes to the throne, particularly in terms of her power? We need to be able to understand, well, who are the different groups that hold power in Elizabethan England, as well as Elizabeth herself? And we want to also ask ourselves, well, what problems did she face as a female ruler? Remember, she was a woman in what was a man's world in terms of power. So what were the specific problems? How were her problems amplified by that? So let's start off with who Elizabeth was and what problems she inherited when she comes to the throne. She is a highly intelligent young woman. And one of the good things about her is she had learned from the mistakes of her family. She had witnessed the problems of the reigns of her sister and her brother and her father and was determined to learn from them. She'd been brought up in the royal court, more of that later on, so she had an understanding of how to handle these very powerful nobles. What else is important? Of course, fundamentally, she was a Protestant. That is going to be just one of the most important themes in her reign, of course. Now, when she comes to the throne at just 25, England faces many problems, and some of which I will just briefly touch upon here. Well, of course, one of the fundamental ones is there was this religious dispute between Catholics and Protestants. Her sister Mary's reign had seen was very tumultuous, with Mary attempting to reassert the Catholic faith after Edward's attempt to sort of cement the Protestant faith, and prior to that, her father, of course, and the beginnings of the Reformation and his split from Rome. So there'd been an awful lot of religious turmoil when she comes to the throne. That's something she's got to address. Secondly, England is at this stage, there is widespread poverty for reasons we'll talk about later on, and there is a need to fund government activity. So there's also going to be the need for new taxation. So how does she square that circle? So financially, she's got problems, and she faces significant threats from abroad. The very powerful Catholic country of Spain with its empire, and France too, another Catholic country. These are both countries that do not want to see a Protestant queen on the throne. And of course, neither did the Pope, head of the Catholic Church. And she also faces problems in Ireland where there is a rebellion. So she's got problems from all sides that she has to deal with. Personally, and we'll come back to this as well, is as a young woman, she is expected to marry. There is an awful lot of pressure on her to have an heir, to continue the Tudor line. Because without an heir, there is always instability. There are always people waiting in the wings that would replace her. And the most prominent one, of course, is her cousin Mary, who is a Catholic, again, who we'll come to later on. So this is the context in which she comes to the throne. So let's think about where the areas of power were and how she dealt with those different areas of power. So the really important group you've got to know are the Privy Council. Now, the Privy Council are made up of the wealthiest landowners, the nobility in the country. They effectively are the government. They are running the country with Elizabeth day to day. They are meeting every week, these 19 or so nobles, all men, and they are helping Elizabeth to come to the decisions she needs to make, and they're helping those to make sure those decisions are implemented. Very, very important group. The management of this group is incredibly important because she doesn't want them to be too united so that they can form a kind of power block against her. And she has to manage their appointment very carefully so that there is a balance of views within there. Now, she can, of course, use her patronage to do this. She can reward or she can threaten. She can give them land, etc., financial incentives, or she can take those away. So you can use that power to manage them. But nevertheless, she can't rule without them. She needs them, and so she has to manage them carefully. Now, her most important advisor and her secretary of state, the key man in the Privy Council, was the chap called William Cecil. And he is her closest advisor really all the way through. Another important member to know here is Francis Walsingham, who was her chief spymaster. So very important group of people, and they're all men, and managing that group was a key skill, which by and large she managed very successfully. Who else held power in Elizabethan England? Well, of course, the royal court is so important. And it's an odd concept, the sort of royal court, but it's the centre of power. She lives in the court. The court is not one place, but it is the place that moves from place to place. And it is where all of the great families, the nobility and all of their households, their servants, etc., they accompany her and are with her either at her palaces, or the court might move and you might have to, at great expense, you as a noble, entertain the queen for a while. And so this is a really important area where all the most powerful people in the country are gather, and they're looking to influence Elizabeth and her decision making. Now, some of these people, of course, are in the Privy Council. Many of them are not. But it's here where people can influence, where she can show her favourites. And if you want to be at the centre of power, you have to have influence in this court. Okay, but it was also a place for pleasure and for fun, as well as a place for politics. Now, again, who are the kind of individuals who are significant? So Lord Lieutenant's really important because these are the people that effectively run different parts of the country. Someone like Cecil was in the Privy Council and the Lord Lieutenant. So they are responsible for administrating the different areas of the country. They're also important. And of course, that's something that the Queen can appoint. She can appoint or sack them. So that's another area of patronage. Her power is the ability to do that. And then, of course, you've got Parliament. Again, really important and growing in significance under the Tudors. And Parliament, by Elizabeth's reign, want a say in how the country is run. Now, the thing is, they've got certain powers. If Elizabeth wants to pass a new law, Parliament has to pass it. If she wants to raise new taxes, they have to agree to it. So they've got something. But on the flip side, of course, she can appoint them or dismiss them when she chooses. So there's a sort of balance. Now, what they want in return for their agreement to raise money and to pass taxes is influence on how the country is won and what happens. They are elected by a very small number of people, but they are a sort of element of democracy, I suppose you could call, in some sense. But Elizabeth's job is to manage all of these different competing powerful groups, and there's some overlap between them, but her job is to do that and still maintain her preeminent position, which pretty successfully by and large she does. There are also justices of the peace, often occupied by people slightly lower down the social order, maybe members of the gentry, which we'll come to again later on, and these people maintain law and order in the different areas. So let's think about the notion of marriage. Marriage is such an important issue throughout Elizabeth's life. There was an enormous pressure on her to marry and have a child in order that there would be an orderly succession. Because what you don't want really is a situation in which civil war might break out if a king or queen died without a clear heir. Also, many of the most powerful people in England during her reign were Protestant, and they were very worried about the idea of a Catholic coming to the throne. So there was a lot of pressure on her, particularly from the Protestant elite, to get married and to have a child. There are also, of course, possible benefits of alliances. A marriage to a foreign prince could create a powerful alliance that would help protect England. But there are an awful lot of drawbacks for Elizabeth. Of course, it was very likely that women died in childbirth at this point. If she married a man, would that man be willing to play second fiddle to her? Or would he want to be king, really, and manage the country? Particularly a problem, of course, if that's a foreigner. If she married an Englishman, would that cause divisions within the court and cause its own problems? And Elizabeth, of course, herself used this possibility of marriage like a carrot, if you like, that she could dangle over people as a means to ensure they didn't necessarily rebel or do anything to her. Now, she had a range of suitors, but none of them were really suitable, from her sort of childhood friend, Robert Dudley, to Philip of Spain, who had been married to her sister, who was very keen to manage her, but none of them were suitable. They were too Catholic, they would have upset other nobles. But really, Elizabeth reckoned that, having seen the experiences of her father and his treatment of women, that she was better off without marrying. Now, you can make your own mind up whether she did the right thing or not, but her reign in some ways does speak for itself, the fact that she reigned for so long pretty successfully, although the succession wasn't decided upon her death, and that was a problem near the end. Parliament was always a challenge for Elizabeth and a frustration, as it was for kings prior and after. And of course, it comes to a head, doesn't it, with Charles I. They wanted influence. They wanted to debate the important issues of the day, and they wanted to give her advice. Again, they're all men, remember? And as we said before, for something to become law, it had to be passed by Parliament and to raise taxes. So this problem that ends up in civil war and the beheading of Charles I, this is not a new problem, but it's always a question of the skill of the monarch to manage this issue. Now, Elizabeth wanted to limit what they discussed. You know, she wanted to be in control, and she especially didn't like some topics. They were keen on talking about her marriage and who she should marry and why she should marry. That she was not keen on, because she could dismiss them when she didn't want to see them. And that gave her a certain amount of power. Now, on some areas, they were largely agreed. Most MPs were Protestant. They were relatively happy with some of her later anti-Catholic laws. But in other areas, there were disagreements. For example, they did not like her use of monopolies, which is patronage. So that's granting someone the sole sale of something. The famous example in our course is Essex, who is granted the sweet wine monopoly. And they didn't like that. They didn't like people being rewarded unfairly, as they would have seen it. And here he is, indeed, the man himself, Essex. Now, Essex's rebellion is put in this section of the course about power because it's the only major rebellion which isn't really about religion. There he is. Essex, apparently known to have the finest legs in England. He was certainly a great charmer. And he was one of Elizabeth's favourites. Her favourites came and went over the time. She loved the company of good-looking young men, and he fitted that mould. Now, the story is that he rose to fame, to prominence, and to be her favourite, and was placed in the Privy Council. But he was a sort of impetuous, ambitious young man, and fell out with her, argued with her, and was sent to Ireland as a sort of punishment to deal with the rebels there. Now, he basically failed to do what he was told in Ireland, came back, apparently walked in on her when she didn't have her wig or her makeup on and upset her, And really, his star waned and he lost his position. And he felt, with nothing to lose, that his best chance was a sort of rebellion. Now, he claimed that he was doing this in support of the Queen and against the Privy Council, the rest of the Privy Council, who he said were undermining her. This happens right at the end of her reign, and it's interesting because it suggests that she was never entirely safe. There was always danger there. However, it's also interesting because it collapsed very quickly, and he was then executed. And it showed us that there wasn't the base of support. And again, so those two things, it showed us he was always in a certain amount of danger, but fundamentally, there wasn't really the support to ensure that that went ahead. And it also showed she was sort of successful and she had she was able to overcome these. I think what this tells us, and what all of this tells us, she has a very good, a brilliant ability to manage the different competing interests within England. And her resistance to marry showed something of her extraordinary strength of character. And really, when you compare her reign to the chaos of the of what came before her, you can see how extraordinarily successful that she, in many ways, she was. Okay, so part two. Now, part two is a bit of a change in direction, and this is about life in Elizabethan England. So what have we got to look at? Well, big questions are, was it a so-called golden age? Was it a great period in English history? And we'll look at the ways in which it was and the ways in which we can be said not to be. We'll look at poverty in particular, because poverty was such an issue, and we'll think about why there was so much and what people thought about the poor and how it was dealt with. And finally, we'll think to ourselves, the next thing is, was this an age of discovery, which is all about the voyages abroad? And so we'll look at those three big questions. So was the Elizabethan era a golden age? There's certainly some things which would suggest that absolutely it was a great and unusual age in lots of ways. So first we can say culturally, some extraordinary things were going on that marks it out. We can talk about the great resurgence in architecture and a particular Elizabethan style, Hardwick Hall in Derbyshire being a good example. Of course, perhaps the most famous thing was the great theatre of the time, Shakespeare being the most famous playwright with his Globe on the South Bank. Entertainment for all, for the first time really, a genuine form of entertainment enjoyed by rich and poor alike, an extraordinary culture that clearly still resonates today. New forms of art and textile making, all of these things in literature. So culturally speaking, music, all of these things, there are things to really celebrate. It was a golden age as well because it was a time of great national pride. England in this Elizabethan era sees great military success abroad, not least with the Armada, and against Spanish privateering, against Spanish vessels. And in a sense, you can say we begin to see the beginning of the British Empire here with these extraordinary voyages of discovery led by Drake, circumnavigating the globe, bringing back extraordinary new things, and sort of planting the flag abroad. So although in a sense, it's not really empire building in this sense, it's the beginning of it, you could argue. It was a time of relative stability compared to what had gone on before. There wasn't a really serious threat to the throne. We'll talk about the rebellions later on, but none of them succeeded. And for the first time, there was religious stability to a large extent. And it was a time of new discoveries in things of science and technology, not least in the kind of area of shipbuilding and navigation, which really helped these voyages of discovery. You begin to see a widening of education. Many more people are learning how to read and write during this period as well, and there's an expansion of children's education, not for the poorest, of course, but for those that are a bit wealthier. And of course, there is a growing middle class, which allows for that expansion. And those voyages of discovery, very important, opening up new trade routes, linking England with the new so-called New World, the Americas, as well as the East, bringing lots of new products to this country and England becoming a global hub in a sense, particularly London, of course. On the other hand, for most people, their lives remained pretty difficult. The poor, of which there were many, remained really poor, and even those with just enough money, their lives were fairly narrow. And not for them, these great new products, and in fact, not even the theatre. If you were in a countryside in the north of England somewhere, you wouldn't have felt this glorious change, really. So life probably changed very little for them. Equally, in terms of medicine and health, very few advances, certainly not for the ordinary people. And some things which we would consider to be cruel, for example, entertainment like blood sports, were very, very popular. It is also true, of course, to say that there was widespread use of torture and execution, and that execution was in public. Hard to say, call that a golden age. So let's consider poverty and how the poor were treated. It was such a big issue in Elizabethan England. Poverty was increasing when Elizabeth came to the throne, and continued to do so for a number of different reasons. Of course, the most important thing really is the population is rising quite dramatically. And then when you combine that with all the other problems, inflation, i.e. price rises, enclosure, that had been a growing trend in agriculture where sheep farming basically replaced growing of crops. You need less people for sheep farming, and therefore people were thrown off their land where they'd lived and worked, and that led to sort of vagrancy. You had a series of poor harvests during the Elizabethan era as well, and you'd had the closure of the monasteries, which traditionally had been employers but had also helped the poorest after the Reformation, and there were other reasons. So poverty, a real problem. Now, this led to a number of effectively what we might today call the homeless, and then those they called vagabonds, who would beg for money, often travelling from place to place without work, begging. And there was a sort of growing fear in Elizabethan England about what to do amongst these people, a moral panic, if you like. Now, at the same time, many wealthy people, they were Christian, and they recognized the Christian need to help the poor, or at least some of the poor. And so there was this sense at the time of the poor being, and in fact we still have this in some sense today, don't we, the deserving poor who deserved help, and then the undeserving poor, those who were lazy, idle, feckless, couldn't be bothered. Was the deserving poor maybe the elderly or orphans, whatever, who deserved help? And this is the way poverty was looked at. Now, there were wealthy individuals that would help with giving alms. So almshouses, you can still see them around today, were built to help usually the elderly poor. And some towns themselves would do things piecemeal to try to deal with the problem. So some of the bigger towns at the time, York, Ipswich, Norwich, etc., they brought in their own systems to dealing with the poor. So that could be a range of things, from licensing beggars so that only beggars from the town could beg there, providing a master beggar to check on the other beggars, or they might provide some form of training for those people who wanted it. But really, punishment was central to how begging was dealt with. You could be whipped, a hole burnt through your ear. You could actually be executed if you're a repeat offender. And this was, there were a series of laws brought out to kind of try to punish this. But there wasn't really any national system for dealing with the poor. And the first time this happens is right at the end of Elizabeth's reign, and it's called the Poor Law. And it's a really important piece of legislation because it's the first time there is an attempt nationally to say that each area has to deal with the poor, and that has to be paid for by the wealthier citizens in that area. And really it came down to two things. One, the deserving poor should be supported into work or through alms, through taxation, whereas the undeserving poor shouldn't be allowed to get away with not doing anything and needed to be placed in so-called houses of correction. These houses of correction become the kind of workhouses made famous later on in the Victorian era. So this approach really fundamentally lasts for hundreds of years, so it has a very long-lasting impact. And although some of it has, there are some good elements to it, there are also, there remains a sort of rather cruel side to it as well. So let's have a look at the last section then. And this is all about how Elizabeth dealt with threats. And there were many during her time, her reign, and they came from within England, but also from outside. So what are the big questions? Well, how did she deal with the religious problems? Most of the threats at home come from this, her attempt to establish a Protestant church, and the fact that Catholics, or a small number of Catholics, did not like this. So we're going to ask ourselves about these Catholic plots. Linked to that, of course, is really importantly Mary, Queen of Scots, her cousin, who is a perpetual thorn in her side, shall we say. And famously, there is, of course, the Spanish Armada. And we will look at that. So let's start with her way to deal with perhaps her biggest problem when she comes to the throne, which is England's religious division. So the Reformation that starts under her father, Henry VIII, meant, well, in England anyway, but of course in Europe it started before, meant that there was a split in the Christian church across Europe. And the split is between this kind of, these Protestants, these people protesting against the things that they see are wrong with the traditional Catholic Church, and they have a different vision for what the Christian Church should be. So that, you know, in effect means getting rid of a lot of the razzmatazz of the Catholic Church, having far simpler churches. And really important, it's about people being able to understand the Bible and the services in the language that they speak. It's about having a direct communication with God as opposed to having it done through a priest or a bishop. The Catholic Church traditionally had loved much greater pomp and ceremony, and really they wanted the power of being able to control the message, and they did that through the use of Latin in England, which of course most people didn't speak. Now, Elizabeth was brought up a Protestant, her mother was a Protestant, and she wanted to establish England like her brother before her as a Protestant country. And so her religious settlement is an attempt to establish England as a religious settlement, but it's also an attempt at compromise. She wanted to find something that both Catholics and Protestants could accept, albeit it was a Protestant country. And she said she didn't want to be a window into men's souls. She was willing to overlook perhaps some Catholic practices as long as the, on the face of it, England was a Protestant country. So for example, Catholics were allowed to worship in private. That was one thing that was sort of tolerated under this settlement. On the other hand, priests wore and at the same time priests wore sort of different clothes that sort of marked them out. Some decoration was allowed in church, but on the other hand there was priests could marry, for example, which was something that was there for Protestants, and the prayer book used under Edward was brought back. So there were things for both sides. Now, the point here is that most people accepted her religious settlement. They wanted peace after the years of the turmoil of Mary's reign. But a few prominent Catholics, nobles, supported by the Pope, who of course issues his so-called papal bull in 1570, where he encourages Catholics to rebel, he says it's their duty to, they do not accept it, and there are several plots during Elizabeth's reign, and most of them involve trying to put Mary, Queen of Scots, on the throne. The other problem she had with the Jesuits, who were Catholic priests who were trained abroad and would come to England to try to convert Protestants. There really isn't any evidence that they were starting a rebellion, but they were standing against Elizabeth's church. Some of these plots had foreign influence as well. And because there are a number of plots, which we'll come to in a moment, what Elizabeth does is she starts in the mood, if you like, for a degree of compromise. But as these plots continue, her willingness to compromise declines, and in fact what she does is she increasingly punishes Catholics. She raises the fines they have to pay for not going to Catholic Church, and then she actually begins to imprison and even execute people, particularly these Jesuit priests. So she cracks down harder on Catholics as time goes by. The other group that caused her some problems are Puritans, or the extreme Protestants. Now they, on the other hand, believe that her settlement isn't Protestant enough, and they feel it's too far a compromise with Catholicism. And they really protest by setting up their own churches and having their own services. But again, she's not willing to tolerate that. Although she tries again to compromise with them through various appointments in her church, ultimately she again brings in harsher measures for those not willing to accept her church. Now they do have certain, there are Puritans within some of the most powerful positions of the court. Cecil is a sort of moderate Puritan. And when those Puritans die, actually, the protection for them goes a little bit. And many of them flee abroad in the end, believing they're not living in a properly Protestant country. Some will come back later on. Of course, we get a much more Puritan country under Cromwell. So how great a threat then were these Catholic plots? As I'll say, I want to repeat, most people accepted her religious settlement. So the plots were from a minority of Catholic nobles, and a lot of them came out of the north. The north and the south of England was very divided then, as now, to be honest. The north could almost feel like a different country. You know, the London was in the south, and power of the monarch was really strongly based in the south. So there was a real sense of anger in the north, in a sense that people talk about now as well, don't they? There were several plots, almost all of them really hoped to put Mary Queen of Scots on the throne, as I said. So the first major one is the so-called Northern Rebellion of 1569, and it's the one that probably comes closest to success, when a couple of Northern earls raise a force, hold the mass in Durham Cathedral and march south, aiming to seize control of London. They are stopped, in fact. And Elizabeth survives that one. There is another one, so-called Ridolfi plot, which is Ridolfi, named after the Italian banker who was supposedly going to raise funds to support this plot. It never gets anywhere. This is uncovered. The plan there, as with the Northern Rebellion, is to put the Duke of Norfolk on the throne as Mary's husband. And in the end, he is executed as a result of this. He's forgiven after the first one, but not the second. There is the Throckmorton in 1583, again uncovered, and the Babington plot, again uncovered. Now, I've mentioned this uncovered because one of the strengths of the Elizabethan monarchy is its ability to uncover plots, and the Babington one is particularly interesting because it involves lots of secret messages, and really Walsingham knew, and Cecil, they knew what was Walsingham knew what was going on, and allowed this plot to continue in order to uncover the plotters, and actually the spying was a really important part of Elizabethan power, and was very successful here. Elizabeth was able really to prevent these plots because she had the spy network, as mentioned, but also because she was prepared to be ruthless when necessary and meted out harsh treatment to her plotters. Poor old Babington and his plotters received particularly nasty treatment, you know, hung, drawn and quartered, and apparently she asked if there could be even a worse punishment for them. So she was tough when she needed to be. And it's also true to say that I think most people did not want this sort of rebellion. They did not want Mary or a foreign Catholic on the throne. So there wasn't a never enough groundswell of support for these really to have succeeded. So let's think about Mary. There she is, a fascinating character and certainly someone who wanted to be Queen of England. She had a good claim to be the English queen because they shared a grandfather and she had a child. So in that sense, she was good. She was Queen of Scotland, but of course she'd been deposed, thrown out of there because of her Catholicism and her behaviour there. She'd had a pretty disastrous life in many ways, and she had come to England hoping to find favour with Elizabeth. But the problem that she was never able to renounce her desire to be Queen of England, and she wasn't willing to be told what to do by Elizabeth. But this, the fact that she's a Catholic is the biggest problem, and the power really lies amongst Protestants at this point, and they are very unwilling to see her get anywhere near the throne. And of course, the other thing is she had a background of terrible scandal with her previous husbands, etc. Now, there was a lot of call amongst the Protestant elite to execute her. But in fact, Elizabeth didn't want to do that. She kept her prisoner for 19 years. It was always, therefore, a problem for what does she do? She didn't really want to execute her, because if you execute a queen, Elizabeth reckoned, then why not her next? She didn't want to do that. She was keen that, you know, kings and queens are appointed by God, so no one's right to kill them. But at the same time, keeping her alive meant she was constantly a threat, as she was. Now, these plots that involved her, there really isn't evidence that she was involved in most of them, but there is direct evidence she was involved in the Babington plot. And it's that evidence, she eventually just got fed up with being kept in these various castles around England. Eventually, she agreed to go along with the Babington plot, and that gave Elizabeth, she couldn't really not do it. Now, her execution, in some senses, was useful for Elizabeth because it got rid of the only genuine Catholic option, and certainly the Protestant elites in Elizabethan England were pleased about it. But, of course, ironically, she remained a martyr, and her son becomes king, albeit he was a Protestant, after Elizabeth. Okay, let's finish by thinking about the Armada, which is this very famous event and is really the crowning glory in some ways of Elizabeth's reign. Now, Philip II, he was furious when Elizabeth refused to marry him. Apparently, she sent him in reply cannonballs. And he was also furious because, of course, she had allowed English privateers like Drake to steal from the Spanish, and the crown had made a lot of money from it. And he was angry at her Protestant faith, and he was angry at her support for Protestant rebels in the Netherlands, which he controlled, and of course then the execution of Mary. He amasses the biggest fleet ever to have been amassed at the time, the famous Armada, as it becomes known, and it sets sail. The plan is to sail to Calais, to meet troops that are coming from the Netherlands, to cross into England and to take over. Now, this never materializes, and it never materializes for a number of reasons. The strength of the tactics of the English Navy, the design of the English ships, the tactics like the use of fire ships while the Spanish are at anchor in Calais, all of these things are the use of, you know, the tactical use of how they're of instead of trying to leap aboard the Spanish ships, they drew up alongside them and broadsided them with cannon. But of course, the weather also plays a serious part. They have a lot of bad luck. The Spanish, first of all, they're struck by storms, and then they have to go back to port, and then they come out again. Key thing is the troops aren't where they're supposed to be, so they're stuck in port. And then even when they do get out, during the Battle of Gravelines, yes, the English proved successful, but then the weather is a disaster for the Spanish, and in the end, the vast, you know, huge proportion of the Spanish fleet and the men are killed. And it was a great victory for Elizabeth and for England, and really helped to end any further religious division in the country. It really helps establish England as a great naval power as well, and as a kind of high point, if you like, of this sense of England being a golden age in England's history.